Good morning, beautiful souls, and welcome to my little video presentation about how to watch cartoons correctly. So this is a very sensitive topic for many families, and I understand that. But however, for our trilingual kids, this is one of the very sensitive and very important parts of their life. So let's learn how to use those resources to benefit their language development. But before we start, let's talk about the downsides of the cartoon. First of all, they are highly addictive. So, and as any addiction, it always creates anxiety of the kids when we separate them with the source of the addiction, right? So whenever you are trying to take away the device or shut down the TV, they always give us a little hard time. Video also can replace real learning and skills, such as exploration, independent play, or simple communications for both parents and the kids. I brought it up because whenever they are busy with this watching videos with the screen time, we also don't have a chance to learn more about them. We don't know or not exploring how we can communicate with them, how we can manage their different emotions, and what is the extent of our own patience. So as to the kids, Oh, screen time always lowers child's EQ, emotional intellect. Again, just think about situations when we give them screen time. As a rule, this happens when they are either anxious or frustrated, or we are frustrated, or both together. And the point is that instead of dealing with emotions, we are numbing them by placing them in front of the just moving pictures. So that is like also questionable gain from the screen time. It also doesn't let our kids to deal with the boredom, because sitting on the top of the boredom is a very important part of the development. Boredom is normal. Life is not only built of ups, it also has downs. And when kids are bored, this is the after some time of being bored, they start using their creativity and imagination. When we give them screen time, they don't have a chance to learn how to deal with the boredom, and this is a lifetime important skill. Also, contemporary screen time, it has very questionable content. Now, when we have so many content creators, it's very difficult to control what exactly is there, what language they're using, if it's beneficial for our kids or not. So, and what purpose they are achieving by watching those videos and stuff. We also have a very cultural erroneous presumption that screen time is entertainment. It came from these past times when we have just TV, and that was like a reason to get family together. Now, when everybody has their own device, that actually separates families. So, and from entertainment that we enjoy together, it becomes a separator that sets us apart. And we are basically not learning about each other. Even inside the family, we still have those ongoing relationships, right? We're learning something new, we're discovering each other. Like, even after many years of being around, we're still growing, especially when we have a kids. So just compare the TV or video or tablet with going to the movie. So these are kind of the same screen time, but their impact is totally different. When you just watch TV, you shut it down and you go to sleep. That is all you do. When you go to movie, the whole family goes to movie. You guys just uninterruptedly watch on the screen. Then when you come out, you start discussing the topic, right? Did you like the movie? What did you like the most? Did you like the actress? What's your opinion about that movie? So you see, this is the same screen time, but the one of them unites and another one separates. So also, and that erroneous assumption came from exactly from TV. And continuously for generations, we've been taught that TV is this is all you need when you are tired coming from home. And we also consider screen time as a routine instead of reward, which is I would say also a questionable thing, and because no matter how much access and how much content we have, for the little kids it should still remain reward. We don't have the Christmas every day. We don't binge on cakes all day long, and we should not binge on TV because that only good when it's limited and in its time, right? And also considering this continuation of the entertainment, right? You have an entertainment idea that TV is, or video or screen time is the entertainment. However, this is not an entertainment, no matter what you think. This is, first of all, information that you consume. The idea of entertainment is when you actually spend time together with your family in the movie theater, but when you are separated in different rooms with different devices and watching different things, this is not the fun. It's a consumption of the information. So whether it's good information or bad information, it is information, and it has its own impact. So this is a part of the selecting the correct information is a part of taking care of yourself and your child. So consider that as self-care, what type of info you listen and watch. Also, it all starts with the healthy family habits. It's impossible to control kids' screen time if it's norm for your family to just like Homer, just lay horizontal on the couch and watch TV all day long. So seeing what you're doing impacts them the most, regardless of what you say. So one, if you want your kids to be really beneficial from screen time, especially when we talk about the trilinguals and multilinguals, it should be like it should be a healthy family habit for the entire family, not only for your kids. So let's talk about like how to watch cartoons correctly so they can become a valuable resource. I'm gonna talk about my own experience and what we did from the beginning, because as you know, I have a girl who acquired three languages at the same time from the birth, and by the age of three, she was quite balanced trilingual. So, but because I have a teacher's background, and at the moment of the child was acquiring languages, I was exactly at the school learning new things. So for me, the question of the screen time never been an issue, and never been an entertainment, as you said. We always practice this precise schema up to the age of probably five, when I changed the habits, because at some point I caught myself thinking that we look like a Amish family, you know, highly Orthodox and Catholic family that doesn't allow kids to do things that normally kids do. And because she is communicating with other kids, she have little information to share with them, right? So she has to be also updated about what's going on in the life of the kids. So then we changed the habits and allowed her from time to time watch popular cartoons for the kids. Shows, not even cartoons, shows. So let's go briefly through the list of things that is I consider like a correctly thing. So make cartoons a highlight of the day. As I said before, this is not a routine. They have to anticipate, wait, and deserve that time. That's the thing number one. Also stick to cartoons that are based on the books that are proven with time. So there are some set of books that we, a set of stories that we consume for centuries already. For instance, all those little stories about Little Red Riding Hood, Goldilocks and Three Bears, Cat in the Boots, Cinderella, all those stories, they were around for many centuries by now. So this is proven with the time. You may like it, may not, it can be a little bit outdated, but we still build a lot of art and information based on that those plots. So what I suggest for the beginning, at the beginning of the life of your kids, stick strictly to those cartoons that have a book behind. And then it comes first stems from that statement is that read book first. Yes, read book first. If you if you limit your child's screen time to a reward, then make it the way as we did. So first we read a novel,
let it be Goldilocks. And then, as a reward, she gets her little cartoon about the same. So she knows now that she has to listen to me until I finish, and then she is gonna watch her little piece of fun. Also, I suggest that because many of those stories have been either translated or updated to the cultural variations and versions of the tale, I also suggest you to find, let's say, Cat in the Boots, right? In English, in your language, and the same happens with the cartoons. Find the cartoon that is produced by, let's say, by Disney or some big brand that are proven to be good, kids approve, and find the cultural version of the tale, because many, many, many countries have been doing their own things for decades. So almost every country has the same tales in different languages with different animation. That's what I'm suggesting you. First read the book, then read the cultural variation of that book that is famous in your culture, then watch one cartoon which is based on that book, let's say classical original version, and then your cultural tale as well. Watch cultural or translated versions, right? This is what I just said. If you don't have like specific cultural version, even better if you would watch the same cartoon translated in your language, doubled in your language, which is very fine, because when you watch, let's say, in English, and then like in our case in Russian, we always made a connection. Oh, I remember this was translated this way in English, that was said in this way in English, but in Russian they translated it completely different. So we were building our like relationship on the similarity and the contrast between original form and cultural variation or translated. Always make a toy or puppet theater to recreate the story with your child. Also, okay, once you finished watching that cartoon, try to recall the story through the play. You can recreate this story by yourself with the puppet theater if the child is quite small, or you can engage into yourself and the child into the play, which is based on the story from the cartoon or from the book, and from the book. Reinforce content through the play. This is what I said. If you have some kind of, like, let's say, scientific content, right, and you have some kind of the experiment, you can recreate that experiment in your kitchen, in your house, or, for instance, like in Busy Town, they had the mysteries, right? So we had a play of solving mysteries, right? It's kind of like a one tale, one book, one cartoon can become a theme for several weeks of playing around this topic, reinforcing the names, events, and a recollection of what she remembers, matching with the recollection of what he remembers, and rebuilding the story over and over again. That type of verbiage is very useful for development of the every language in your house. And of course, if you're kind of watching English, then you speak about this cartoon in English. If you watch in Russian or in your language, you speak about that cartoon in Russian. It's kind of like a common sense, right? But the point is that both of those topics are reconciled between, the vocabulary is also reconciled in one language and in second language. And as to the third language, we always use the daddy at the end of the day. He also been reading according to what we were watching and reading in other languages. But of course, he didn't reconcile his language in the play, because once or twice is enough for the kids, unless they are willing to continue on their own. And of course, if there is scientific content, yes, you can recreate those experiments all day long. And optional for the favorite cartoons, you may acquire dolls of the characters. Like in our case was a Peppa Pig. So Peppa Pig was our biggest fan for probably almost 2 years. And of course we got every single character from, and the dollhouse and the vehicles and all the stuff that is included into that. If you've been playing and playing with those toys over and over again, and Peppa Pig is very good quality, simple verbiage It is translated in every single language. Even now we're using this for Chinese. Because that's her favorite characters and she loved them. And we also brought lots of from cartoons into reality, like jumping in muddy puddles. That's kind of fun that we borrowed from the Peppa Pig. And the main thing about how to do it correctly is never follow the lead of your child. Lead the child to the quality content only. Because kids don't care. They have so far, when they deal with that type of video and knowledge, like that video information, they don't have opinion. They simply never met that before. So you are the one who decide what type of books they are going to read and what type of cartoons they are going to read. And if they don't like it, too bad for them. They have to deal with that. Because dealing with the content that is not entertaining or boring is a part of the dealing with the reality. Not all things are fun in this life, so you have to deal with the bad. It's the same like with the food. My husband says there are some yucky things that you have to eat, but they are very healthy. And there are some tasty things that are super unhealthy. So that's the same applicable to the videos. There are yucky and boring things that are helpful and useful for their language development. And there are like super engaging and entertaining things that are absolutely garbage. So you are the one who leads them to the good quality content and to... Under the good quality content, we are considering the books that are proven with the time. Because there are so many cartoons that have zero impact on the kids, our kids. And I can give you an example of the Tom and Jerry, the early Disney. They are literally a garbage. Now let's take a look at the example, how we read the Snow White and how we watch cartoon about the Snow White and Seven Dwarfs. So there is a classical novel, a European novel with a Disney pictures from cartoon, and in Russian language we have the same story about the Snow White, but it's a cultural version. It was done by our poet Pushkin, and the story is a poetry. It has a little bit different name, like it was a tale about the dead princess and seven knights. We also had the book in Spanish. It was the responsibility of our father to read at night. But that book was just a translation of this, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, but in Spanish with the same pictures from the Disney. In Russian, there was because it was a cultural version, we had a specific drawings and we have different cartoon for that tale. So what I suggest you to do, if you have a couple languages or even three languages, get three identical books. That could be either translation of this classical tale, or it could be cultural version of the tale. And always before embarking on the cartoon, read the book first. Read one book, read the second book. If there are other like similar tales, because folklore is kind of quite similar across the cultures. So you can find similarities in many tales. So if you know that there is one tale that looks like that tale from the European repertoire, so you can easily bring it on. And what happens next? So first you deal with the text. You read slowly, pointing to unknown vocabulary, explain this vocabulary. That could be the entire weekly project, reading the book first, right? As we did, we kept the two books at the same time. I mean, on my laps, there were two books, one of them in English and another one in Russian. And what we did is, like, I've been reading one paragraph in English, and at the same time, I've been reading, let's say, paragraph in Russian. And we were doing comparison and the contrast. So comparing the text together with the child. So I was like, oh, look, in English it says like this, and in Russian we have a little bit different. And she was asking, like, why? Why it is different? I said, this is the same story, and in our culture we decided to make it a little bit closer to cultural standards and the environment that we had at that time. So that's why the author decided to change the tale. We've been reading like paragraph here, paragraph there, and father was doing his own pace at night. What is this? What we've been doing at that moment? So that is called metalinguistics. So when we are talking about language in language, that is called metalinguistics. So it's a higher order of thinking when you engage the young child to comprehend the text from the position of analysis, to make an analysis and compare two books together, which worked for me at any age. Of course, we're talking about like at 1 year old, you use different types of books, and at three, these are different types of books. But don't be afraid of introducing a little bit more complex books No matter what your child is understanding, after this method, the knowledge is going to get solidified. So you slowly read, compare with another book, read the third one in a different language, and discuss this topic. Slowly discuss every single paragraph with the child. Ask him to, or her, to retell you, to tell what he or she got from what you just read. So in general, just slowly reading. And also make your research beforehand and find all the cultural versions of cartoons of that tale. So as I said, we have in Russian both book and cartoon, which is, they were very beautiful, as you can see on the pictures, and there is a Snow White from Disney. So after finishing books, when you completely finish the story, then only bring the cartoon on. First, again, one in English, another one in Russian, and you can do the contrast and comparison, be next to your child and watch together with the child those cartoons. And I would suggest get the full length movies. No such thing as like shortened versions or updated for English language learners. Take the full blown cartoon that is done originally. So watch the classical full length cartoon version of the tale in all of the languages. And be sure that kids love repetitions. Don't worry, they are not gonna get bored. That's the only thing, that they are not gonna get bored for sure. So don't watch cartoons before the book. Keep an intrigue. So it's then cartoon becomes a reward. My child, after some time, she learned, like, after every book is gonna be cartoon. So she was rushing me, let's finish the book, and then I can watch cartoons. Child has a understanding of routine and procedure, that you are not gonna get your cartoon before we finish that book. And she played along. Yes, she was buying this type of the routine. Then after we finished reading the books, watching cartoons, then after that make a play or puppet show. The purpose of this is to reinforce the content of the book and cartoon, and it is an introduction into retail and reinforcement of vocabulary. In this case, you just say, okay, what's the name of these seven little people? Oh, all right, you know that these are dwarves, but how do we call them in Russian? Were they dwarves in Russian? So even like bringing the set of the puppets on the table and then discussing each character, trying to recall, was it that character grumpy or he was happy? Who liked to eat the most? Who was the kindest? Who was the evil one? So let the child point with the finger to all these toys. You can reinforce any type of the knowledge in these games. The point is that they should be recognizable characters there. So the child, just by looking at this setup and the characters, should know what is this story is going to be about. Of course, depending on the age, child can be active participator or passive witness. No matter what age, it still works, because the kids are known for having an implicit learning. Unless their eyes are opened and ears are listening, they're learning from you something. And if you are engaging your child into the conversation, that would be even better for both of you, because now when the child starts speaking and producing some sentences, description of the characters and the describing of the plot, you can see what the child got from those cartoons, so you can control the language that they comprehended. In our case, we had this wonderful set of figurines. It was a jigsaw puzzle, and at age around 3, I think, she was absolutely into jigsaw puzzles. And it actually started way earlier, but this one is first you see the task for them, then there is an order of the story, and then closure on the story. And this puzzle, so the child puts puzzle together, and then you can again reinforce the development of the plot. So there was a girl, then she met the boy, then she'd been sent to the woods, and there was the lady came and gave her apple, she ate the apple, she fell asleep, and then he found her, and so on and so on and so on. And of course, there was a little castle like this, so my kid played a lot with that. At Snow White, Once Upon a Time, Jigsaw Puzzle, Flow by Crocodile Creek, they don't produce them anymore, I think. It is what it is. So any toy that looks like the characters and setup from the cartoon is good. So once you finish playing with those things, you are not testing knowledges, okay? You are just conducting the conversations about what you just seen or what you've just read. So there are how many other cartoons? There are a bunch of them. The same. We have a cultural versions of the, for instance, Cinderella, classical Disney. she looks like this, and this, you see different little things that's going on with Cinderella, the shoes. The same in Russian is called Zolushka, different name, but the story is totally identical. And then we have a French classical book, and I can assure you there are many, many more. How many more? Well, basically anything from Disney is based on some sort of old novel. Moreover, like I told you, that there are cultural tales of in every single country. For instance, in English-speaking countries, there is a gingerbread man. The same plot and story in Russian is called Kolobok. Here there was a gingerbread man, and in Russian there was a round thing, which was that's archaic name was Kolobok. So it's made of the bread around ball that they baked. So and the story is the same. So in this case, gingerbread man was running from different people and different animals. The same here with the Kolobok. So first Kolobok ran away from the grandpa and grandma, then he met bunny, then he met wolf, bear, and finally the one who ate him was the fox. Same story. And this is easily to connect. Even though the characters don't look alike, the story is so connectable. What else? We also have this Charles Perrault. It was a French author. I think he's the author of everything. There is Red Riding Hood. Little Red Riding Hood is also, let me see. In Russian, we don't have it, but we have direct translation. Some of the stories are directly translated. Others, they were like culturally modified. So anything from Disney could be considered as a good type of the videos, because all of them can be backed up with the books. But as I said, book first, then cartoon, then play, and the same. So we have like, there are books that you can buy right now is Disney Bedtime Favorites, and the same Disney Bedtime Favorites, but in the Spanish. These books we have Pinocchio, then Jungle Book, the Aladdin, the Peter Pan, Dalmatians, all of those stories. Well, some of them based on the cartoons, and others were before cartoons. So one of the sets that I found in my life, it was the Ibu Fairy Tale Spin to Play game. Even though they recommend like age from 3, the good thing about this play is that when you buy one set, and it has props from almost every single fairy tale, not at least contemporary modern well-known fairy tales. All sets are here. If the child is small, just give him or her to play. Maybe you can discuss. Here is like a unlimited creativity for you both. You can use the toys that you have at home to rebuild some episodes of any tale, because the major characters are all here. Just in case, so this is for you, so you know there is such thing. Again, there are many cartoons that are based on the classical fables, right? Aesop's fables are well-known. Almost every single culture has its own book and cartoon. So stick to those classical novels. First of all, they are classical because there is always a moral, as my husband said in Spanish, enseñanza. He loves to give moral advices, right? So he was the one who actually, after each reading, asked the child, so what was the moral of this story? Especially this fabulous, the Aesopo, they were enjoying this book probably for one entire year. And as a reward, of course, he gave her cartoons in Spanish about those fabulous. And I was, because we have almost the same in the many classical folklore tales, some of those stories are in the books and in cartoons. So you see, there's a free books of the certain tales that all of them have both and text and cartoon, and based on the props. There are a bunch of art based on this. There are classical paintings based on the Aesop tales, and there are contemporary ideas. So you see, you just get the free books, and then the entire internet is yours, because you always know that you give a very well designed content to your child through the cartoons. So that's because of this approach, we never had issues with screen time, because she knew there is a book first, then cartoon, then we're gonna play for several weeks, sometimes whatever it takes. And she never questioned this order of things. Well, in general, I understand that you guys already have your own routine connected to the cartoons, and it's very difficult now to change something for many of you. What I would say, just swap whatever they watch, your kids, into something which is proving good quality content, right? Visuals, they should be books. My favorite is the best book I ever met was the best word book ever, right? So, by Richard Scarry. So what we have here first, of course, A in English, amazing drawings. She spent like, I don't know, hours and days and months just going through each page, looking at the subject, object. So this is book that gives just entire like load of new vocabulary, even for me, because I'm keeping those books still just from time to time to look in the names of the tools. There is the same book in Russian. And the best part of that is that there are so many free episodes of the cartoon, which is called Busy Town. Yeah, I think Busy Town. So after reading this, we watch cartoons. But I discovered them way later. I was just like browsing, like questioning, like, just let me check if this book has any cartoon, because he's very famous and for drawings, there might be something. So when I looked, I found a lot of these amazing cartoons. I just love them. But we didn't finish here, right? There is a game based on this Busy Town. I found a game. Probably one of the games that is like best loved ever in our household. And it's all just because of this combination of the book, cartoons, game. And the game was like finding different things, right? I spy kind of thing. And there are rules, and you can lose it, and you can win it. And the child can play on his or her own, we can play in pairs. And the best part is that the child doesn't have to know how to read that. So it's pretty much, probably we spent 1 year just dealing with this book. So you see, cartoons are not separate from the other types of the content. It's just a part. It always goes like a puzzle together. Because if you remove the book, then the cartoon itself is like pointless. And if you don't add the play to the cartoon, even more pointless. Like, why the child in general watching this piece of video if you are not gonna do anything with that? The same like reading books without doing anything about that. So you read the book, play the game. You read the book, ask to retell. You read the book, watch video. But it never goes separate. So that's why I was been asking many of you, like, are you sure you know how to read? Like, for us, for our trilingual household, that's the only way how we really been able to uplift all of the languages at the same time, because we basically been on the same page, or literally on the same page with each language, with all three of them, right? And it doesn't take much time. So if you think that you're a full-time working mama and you only have 1 hour a day, that approach works. It's gonna get a little bit slowly, but what you do, you just read one page, which is also good. Starting to read chapter books to a kid as early as possible really leads to the improvement of their memories. Because you read one page, you read another page, that's not too much work, it's just maybe half an hour. Then you play a little bit with your child and then give him or her cartoon. One episode of Busy Town is like that. It's gonna be entertaining, it's on the top of the books and the content, new words, and I don't know what else you wanna know about this. Of course, we have the same with Eric Carle. Eric Carle, as you know, he has enormous amount of the books and different type of the toys, and also the amazing cartoons. These are probably cartoons for the child like after 1 to 2 years old, but even my 5 years old still enjoy them. Actually, my kid enjoys anything. So you see, there's like with the music, and they use also very nice music. For Erykarly, there is unlimited opportunities, just like to infinity and beyond. The same with the Goodnight Moon, but these books, Erykarly and Goodnight Moon, and then like Blue Truck, all of them has some type of the cartoon behind. It's also not cartoon. It's like kind of like a story time. Some of them there are story time. So you, whenever you have a question, just Google, because so far I realized that almost every single book in this world already have a video content or like video version of that book. So just browse. Always give it in the combination, never give it separately. You can read the book separately, definitely, but it should be followed up by the game. You can give the book and cartoon. You can give the book, cartoon, and game. So never read them separately. For the because trilinguals have very limited time of spending in each of the languages, this is gonna be just a language booster. And this is precisely what makes them balanced. For the older age, right now we are at 5, so we have this Moomin Troll thing. This is also amazing, just like on the top of the amazement. My kid, we are reading currently right now this book, all about the Moomin Trolls. So if I'm not mistaken, this is from Sweden, I guess, very famous in Europe. So this is a good quality literature. This is a good quality literature that is taking all sort of layers of human relationships so your child can learn. And plus, right now I noticed that there are Japanese cartoons. We just found them, but I don't show her all of them yet because we haven't finished book yet. So, but those chapters that we already finished, she has already watched the cartoons, and she's not complaining. I said, we've read this this story, so you're free to watch those cartoons. The other stories we haven't finished yet, so please don't touch them. And she doesn't touch. So that's the relationship with the video is all about how you set it up from the beginning. In our family, it's like non-negotiable: book first, cartoon, play, weekend to some art, or maybe like free printable or whatever. And but always like this. Never, nothing goes separately. Always any like source of information goes in the pair. And for Russians, we have, again, a set of books that are for specifically for children. All of them have classical, beautiful, from 50s cartoons that I enjoy watching, like to infinity and beyond, because these are cartoons from my childhood. Plus, when there is a poetic, because I don't know why Russians used to like so much poetry, right? A good thing to do with your child is also learn by heart small pieces of poetry from the younger stage. So you can recite anything, basically anything, especially the Blue Truck book. That is a book where there is a lot of repetition and it's good to learn it, yes, for the sake of something. Another thing that I forgot to mention here is just there are always songs based on their many stories, right? Or based on many topics. So using topics and poetry is a good idea. Okay, and then let's wrap up. So the general idea is that read the book first. Read it in every language, read cultural versions of that tale, and only that, when you finish everything, then watch the classical full-length cartoon. Make it, like, bring the popcorn, make it Friday movie night, put the whole family together. So make it an event. And then you can continue with the plays, puppet toys, theater. It's all just about your imagination. If you can sing, if you can dance, so all about you. That was it. Thank you for your attention and visiting me on this little lecture. I hope that was a little bit clear about the watching cartoons. As I said, this lecture is probably for the overachiever moms,
But I can guarantee you, doing things right from the beginning leads to amazing results later. So, and plus, it's proven because I'm also now full-time working. And so it's possible to do even after daycares, child cares, instead of dumping your kid in front of the gadget, you can just read and then dump them in front of the gadget. But always take care of the content. So thank you and see you later.